गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबडी. आई एम डॉक्टर शशांक जोशी एंड आई एम एन एंडोक्रिनोलॉजिस्ट एट द लीलावती हॉस्पिटल. आई एम नाउ गोइंग टू पिक अप माय फ्रेंड एंड एल्डर ब्रदर डॉक्टर विजय पणिकर एंड वी आर वेलकमिंग बोथ ऑफ अस टू द इंडियाज फर्स्ट मेटाबॉलिक रोडिनार. We'll be talking on all aspects of life, including diabetes and its treatment. We will be driving today to the world famous Sanjay Gandhi National Park.
नेशनल पार्क में मैं लास्ट कब आया था 1970 में.
मैं 3 साल का था तो.
शाबाश. नहीं मैं तब 15-16 साल का था.
किसके लिए आया था?
अरे कॉलेज से बॉटनिकल एक्सकर्शन के लिए आया था. कैनरी केव ये वो सब.
सो डिड यू नो दैट टाइम दैट यू विल बिकम अ डॉक्टर एंड अ डायबिटोलॉजिस्ट ऑफ वर्ल्ड फेम?
यस यस. नो आई डोंट नो अबाउट डायबिटोलॉजिस्ट बट डॉक्टर तो जरूर बनने वाला था मैं. इंटर साइंस एंड देन वी केम. इट्स अ वंडरफुल.
Yeah, I know. It's nature and
nature is
going. We are living in concrete jungles.
Yes.
So I don't think there was any diabetes that time.
Diabetes was always there, but it has increased over the years now.
Correct.
And now, अभी क्या है? इतने अभी drugs आ गए हैं, इतने guidelines आ गए हैं.
When you entered medical school, what were the agents we were using?
अरे that time, see, I joined MBBS 71. That time, what did we have? We had a sulfonylurea, clopropamide, tolbutamide.
Mm-hmm. All gone.
And we
you
had
DBI also? That
yes,
metformin.
Fenformin and metformin. That's okay. All that we had.
Okay. And insulin?
And insulin, of course. And animal insulin.
Animal insulin, okay.
Yes. The Lente and the plain insulin. And now things have evolved.
Yeah.
We have now how many? We have 6 oral agents. 2 injectables, GLP-1 and insulin.
Correct.
And we have a whole host of guidelines.
Correct. But do you think what were the 2 big changes which occurred in the last 2 decades?
See, last 2 decades, the changes that occurred were in the understanding of diabetes, the understanding the pathophysiology of diabetes, and newer drugs addressing that pathophysiology of diabetes. That has been the game changer in the management of diabetes in terms of the sensitizers, the glitazones, the DPP-4 inhibitors, the SGLT-2 inhibitors. These are the new ones which came. And they have changed the scenario and they have changed the guidelines also.
Correct.
Initially, see, guidelines used...
I remember almost 20 years back, we wrote a paper which you championed that you should start triple drug therapy at the beginning.
Yes, yes.
Can you tell us what was the thoughts that time? And now, US FDA is also saying this should be the first line.
True.
So probably it took United States unka tublet betne ko 20 saal laga.
Yes. And if you remember, our paper on triple drug was probably the first in the world.
Probably.
As the triple drug combination, and that is when all the companies came out with the triple drug combination of a sulfonylurea, metformin and a pioglitazone.
Correct.
And then we had those other papers using DPP-4 as the 4th drug.
Correct.
Using SGLT-2 as the 5th drug.
Yes.
So. Right. Depending on the pathophysiology, we have done a lot of things. Now, let me ask you. See, the things have changed. Guidelines have changed. What do you think about the HbA1c targets?
See, A1c targets were never rigid. In fact, when even I did medical school, there was nothing like an A1c. We only concentrated on fasting and PP.
Correct.
And we are coming back to that. We are coming back to something called glucose in range or time in range. A1C target for non-pregnant adults was 7%. They said if you are young, if you don't have complications, keep it at 6.5 or below. If you are elderly, if you have limited lifespan, keep it at 7.5. So actually it has been a moving target, you know, between 6.5, 7 and 7.5. And the old adage was tight control, tight control.
that actually relaxed.
Correct. You know? अभी क्या है चलता है यू नो इफ यू आर डोंट गो वेरी टाइट इफ यू आर हैविंग टू मेनी कॉम्प्लिकेशंस दैट्स हाउ द होल पैथोफिजियोलॉजी चेंज्ड
वेरी ट्रू एंड द रेट लिमिटिंग स्टेप इन टाइट कंट्रोल इज हाइपोग्लाइसिमिया
एब्सोल्युटली एंड वेट गेन
या सो वी हैव टू लुक एट विच आर द ड्रग्स विच विल कॉज नो हाइपोग्लाइसिमिया
करेक्ट
सो इन दैट वॉट कम्स टू माई माइंड इज देर ओनली टू मॉलिक्यूल्स विच विल एक्चुअली कॉज हाइपोग्लाइसिमिया Sulfonylurea and insulin.
Correct.
If you avoid those two molecules, we don't have hypoglycemia.
Absolutely.
And what was the second one you said?
Weight gain.
Only two molecules which can cause hypoglycemia, sulfonylurea and insulin.
Hmm.
And you said weight gain.
That is true because see weight gain is the other rate limiting step. As you said, hypoglycemia is one rate limiting step.
Correct.
The other rate limiting step is weight gain. And for weight gain, we actually want molecules which will not only have a challenge but cause weight neutrality in a weight loss.
Correct.
And now we are getting modern age molecules which are likely to be in that space like semaglutide coming up very quick and fast.
Correct.
But what has happened now beyond hypoglycemia and beyond weight gain, something else dramatically happened in the last decade. That is suddenly all these outcomes started coming. Formerly we used to only look at clinical outcomes.
Correct.
And from clinical outcomes we moved to cardiovascular outcomes, renal outcomes, cancer outcomes. So Vijay, how have outcomes changed diabetes therapy today?
See, basically if you look at the outcomes, the best outcomes have been with the SGLT2. The EMPIRE-X study really showed it was a revolutionary game changer. That you had cardiovascular benefits, you had renal benefits. And that has changed the scenario. And now you have a semaglutide and a liraglutide, which also has shown cardiovascular benefit. So you have a GLP-1 analog, and you have SGLT-2, which have got cardiovascular benefits. And that has been the game changer in the treatment.
But Vijay, this GLP-1, no? They are like COVID, predictably unpredictable. Some work, some don't work.
Doctors
in India never took off the GLP-1 therapies, you know?
No, that's mainly because it's injectable and it's expensive.
So you feel if it is oral and Sundar Sasta Majboot, people will use it?
Yes, if it is oral and if it is Sundar Sasta Majboot, I am sure it will.
But wo kidney or pancreas ko thok nahi dega. They say it can cause pancreatitis, it can cause kidney damage.
See, those are relative. It's not absolute. So that is something which we have to live with.
So you don't mind it?
I don't mind it if it is Sundar Sasta Majboot.
Okay. What about SGLT2 inhibitors? Do you think they will change? Do you think metformin will be replaced? I personally feel SGLT2 inhibitors have become so much that even water will have SGLT2. Anyway, they remove water, they remove glucose. So now, you know, you think that they are going to be literally like the next metformin?
No, see, metformin will remain. Metformin is a wonderful drug. And you have SGLT2, which is another classy drug, which can be really combined together very nicely.
So should the combination be first line?
Yes.
But I mean, suppose somebody is lean and kakadu like me, then what, will you give me SGLT2 and metformin? I will become half my size for them.
No. See, the weight loss with SGLT2 is 1 or 2 kilos. Nothing great. And if you have an adequate diet, that also
are you worried
come.
About this mycotic infections or about this
yes.
kidney renal infections?
See, basically 3-4% of the patients do develop genitourinary infections across the body. In our own study, we have seen.
So rather than using metformin, don't you think if we use a gliptin, which will inhibit a DPP-4 enzyme in the fungi and bacteria, that is a better option?
That could be one theoretically.
Okay, but have you seen that practically?
Not really.
Okay. And you know, there
because
are different
we have
types.
Not, we have not really analyzed the data to see compared to with a DPP-4 and without a DPP-4, what is the incidence of mycotic infections. I mean, we have not looked at that data as
well. And
such.
One more thing, Vijay, we have all these evidence-based molecules in SGLT2 space, but we also have generic molecules which have not got the outcome studies.
Yes.
How do you compare and contrast both?
Yes. See, now when you talk of the empagliflozin, your canagliflozin, dapagliflozin, they have got all the data which is there. Now, DAPA has come in generic. No issue. It's available. Remogliflozin doesn't have any studies done. No problem. Now, DAPA today, there is a different molecule compared to what the parent molecule is.
Why? I don't agree with you. I think it's the same.
No.
See, because India has been the reverse chemistry capital of the world.
Correct.
And when India is the reverse chemistry capital of the world...
No, but if you see, all these molecules are also approved by USFDA.
Correct.
Yes,
correct.
So there is no issue. So generic can be used, and DAPA generic has become a game changer because cost has come down drastically.
But with all this, don't you think EMPA has a lead advantage? They have Emperor, they are the Emperor in the SGLT2 class?
No, why? DAPA also has similar. DAPA HF, DAPA CKD, very comparable.
Okay.
If not better.
And CANA was amputated, but do you think it has come back?
No, see, CANA is also a good molecule. And if you look at even our own data, the weight loss has been maximum with CANA compared to the other SGLT2s.
Correct.
So all the SGLT2s across the board are good.
Do you think this oral semaglutide, which has been so touted, is more of a hype and less of a substance?
Only time will tell us that.
But semaglutide doesn't have a positive CV outcome trial.
Correct.
The injectable version.
Correct.
So, you know, they are trying to pioneer. Now they are doing soul searching. So do you think that soul searching will really yield them results?
I don't know. But it can. I mean, it's a good molecule. Weight reduction is good. Cardiovascular outcomes, there are trials which show cardiovascular outcome, but not up to the mark.
See, Vijay, if you walk into my clinic and I have to give you a triple, I will definitely give you metformin SGLT2 inhibitor with a gliptin as a triple. Or maybe a glitazone because you are pioglitazone.
Yes.
Okay, but if I walk into your clinic for diabetes, what will you give me as a triple?
I will give you metformin pioglitazone and a SGLT2.
Fantastic.
So there will be no weight loss. Your cardiovascular will be protected, renal will be protected, even your brain will be protected.
Great. Fantastic. Vijay, it was lovely having you on this Rodinar. And at least it is not a Rodinar, actually. We are on a so-called, it's raining here. And, you know, it's like raining. Like it's raining SGLT2 inhibitors.
Correct.
You know?
So it is Varsat mein tak dina din.
Combination therapy has arrived now.
Yes, sir.
So absolutely. When do you think we should use the combination? I mean, what would be your patient profile where you use the combination?
See, basically, Shashank, the way I look at it is, what do you want the patient to do? You want to save the patient's kidney, his heart, give him a proper, decent, good glycemic control without hypoglycemia and weight gain. So what are the drugs that will help in that? It's a metformin, it's a DPP-4, it's a SGLT-2, and maybe the GLP-1 analog. These are the drugs which will address these problems. And you need combinations of these. In the US, I think you already have a combination of a metformin, DPP-4, and a SGLT-2.
So now with this combination therapy, in your pecking order, which would be the number one, number two, number three combinations? If cost is not an issue.
Yeah, if cost is not an issue, basically, see, metformin is the primary drug for everybody. On top of that, next, if you don't want to use a pioglitazone, you have a combination of a DPP-4 and a SGLT-2. That's the next thing. Because that will address the pathophysiology of type 2 diabetes.
Switching gears a little bit, do you think prime time has come for combining injections?
Combining injections meaning?
For example, now there are combo packs of a GLP-1 with a basal insulin.
Can be done. Can be done. Because if you have a long-standing diabetes whose sugars are not really getting controlled only with the GLP-1, adding a basal insulin would definitely be on the cards.
Great. What do you think is future of diabetes? You know, you have seen 4 decades of diabetes now.
Yes. Diabetes has evolved very well. Diabetes, pathophysiology, understanding the diabetes treatment has evolved and it is still evolving. You are going to see many, many more new facets coming in terms of understanding the disease and in terms of the treatment. I see a great future for the diabetic patients in terms of reducing complications, in terms of life expectancy in terms of morbidity reduction, it's going to be good with the kind of new molecules that we are having online.
So people living with diabetes have a much better future. My journey with Dr. Panikkar started at Leelavati Hospital, where we work together as partners. He's like an elder brother to me. He has mentored many people across the world, and our journey will continue. Our common goal is single: to help people living with diabetes to have better lives, to have complication-free diabetes, to ensure that they are happy and healthy. And that's our motto, that's our theme. Thank you so much for joining us today on this wonderful
tour. Let me add here, this combination therapy of Panikkar and Shashank is something which is unique in our country. In fact, we get along like a house on fire without actual fire being there. So that's what it is. So combination therapy is here to stay. That is what the message would be.
Hello friends, I'm Dr. Rajiv Kovil from Mumbai. Today, two of my colleagues, Dr. Vijay Panikkar as well as Dr. Shashank Joshi, took you around Bombay to National Park, and they shot and spoke about the greenery of Bombay, which is a rarity actually, and also spoke about an FDC of SGLT2 plus DPP4 inhibitor. And I'm going to summarize this portion today. Now, we all know that type 2 diabetes is a progressive disorder, and the beta cells kind of the functional capacity keeps going down every year. And we have to be very, very proactive in our approach. And we cannot be having the conventional approach where we add a drug when another drug fails. We have to be extremely proactive. We add multiple drugs which attack probably multiple pathophysiological defects. And now we have a more pathophysiological approach rather than a glucocentric approach. So this helps in the longer period of time. And India as such has been the capital of FDC. But it's very important that we add on FDCs which actually have synergy in them. We add on FDCs which work together rather than just adding on FDCs because there are two anti-diabetic drugs. Now, whenever we control HbA1c or chase blood sugar, the rate limiting step has always been hypoglycemia. Now, if we had two drugs which were insulinotropic, if there's synergy in their actions, we could easily combine these two drugs and make sure that the patient's quality of life is better. And again, if those two drugs come cheaper than they being individually given, it's actually a feather in the cap. Now, that is what the SGLT2 plus DPP4 FDC comes with. It comes with the promise of a drug put together. It comes with the promise of a synergy in action. It also improves compliance because we have always seen that when the pill burden goes down, compliance is much, much better. Now, when do we use an FDC of SGLT2 plus DPP4 inhibitors? The most common type is when we want to make sure that the patient does not get a hypoglycemia and patient is more than 1.5 to 1.8% away from target. So when we have to use an FDC, like the ACE says that you need to use an FDC when your HbA1c is more than 7.5% at least. And that's what we would recommend, that when your HbA1c is at least 1 to 1.5 or maybe more than 1.5% above target, you should use an FDC plus SGLT of FDC of SGLT2 plus DPP4 inhibitor. Now, what is the advantage of using this SGLT2 plus DPP4 inhibitor? Most important thing is that the DPP4 inhibitors have placebo-like side effects. They have hardly any drug-to-drug interactions. Two, they actually address the paradoxical hyperglucagonemia, which is a pathophysiological defect. SGLT2s, we know that they reduce the tubular reabsorption of glucose, and that's how they increase glycosuria. But in turn, they could also increase the portal concentration of glucagon and in turn cause hepatic gluconeogenesis and increase hepatic glucose output. So when you combine a DPP4 plus SGLT2, you are actually negating this. And that is why there is going to be a synergy in action. And that's why an FDC of
SGLT2 plus DPP4 inhibitors will make sure that they complement each other's action. You're going to get patients under control, and the durability of control will be for longer period of time. That's why make sure you use a combination of FDC plus SGLT2 for its complementary action. Also to make sure that the pill burden is lower, compliance is better, and patients will come to control to a better HbA1c using a good pathophysiological approach. That is in summary from me on this very important topic of SGLT2 plus DPP4 inhibitor as an FDC. And we will again see you next week with another top two KOLs who will discuss basic sciences as well as therapy-related sciences in probably a completely new destination. Thank you so much for a patient hearing.
Right there.